You're listening to the Straight to Video Podcast with Rob Lane.
What's up, and welcome along to the Straight to Video Podcast. Hope you're all doing good out there. Today's guest is bassist Adam Kury, who I spoke to recently from his home out in California. It's always cool to me how you cross paths in various ways with people, and Adam is no exception. Through my friend Danny Gruff, he made me aware of his roommate and fellow singer-songwriter Dave Giles. Dave writes and performs some great acoustic-based Springsteen-esque tunes, but one of his greatest strengths is the way he makes his fan base really feel part of his journey. And that came to its, let's say, crowning glory when he launched a crowdfunding campaign to record an album out in Nashville. The project was a success, and Dave headed to the States and made the album Tennessee and 48th. To celebrate the launch of this great new record, Dave managed to get the musicians who performed on the songs to come with him from the US and play them out on tour. And one of those guys was bassist Adam Kury. So you still with me? Back in 1992, he joined the band Legs Diamond as his first professional gig and still performs with them to this day. He would later team up with Kevin Martin of the multi-platinum band Candlebox, and they would work together in the band The High Watts until 2007 when Candlebox reformed and still record and play live. Currently though, Adam is focused on his new band Sons of Silver, who spawned from the Pete RG band who accompanied my mate Dave on his UK tour. Sons of Silver have released a great new EP called Doomsday Noises, which is available now, and you can listen at sonsofsilver.com. I had a really fun time talking to Adam, and I hope you enjoy it too, and maybe check out Sons of Silver or even grab a listen to the Dave Giles album which Adam recorded bass on. So here we go with my straight-to-video chat with bassist Adam Kury of Sons of Silver. From originally, as I heard, your dad was in the military, right? So did you move around a lot? Or
we moved around a ton. Actually, I'm technically have dual citizenship with the UK. I was born in Scotland.
Oh wow.
Yeah my dad was stationed up in I think there was a base, Edsel, up in Scotland. There is where his first deployment, where I was born. But then we lived all over the world. I mean, Thailand was my first memories of life were in Thailand. Then we spent a couple of consecutive runs in Germany, two different cities in Germany. And we moved back to the States when I was 9 years old, somewhere around there.
So was that your first kind of experience of America at 9 years old?
Pretty much, other than in between Thailand and Germany, we spent the holidays at my grandparents, actually a whole bunch of relatives in upstate New York, waiting to go to Germany. So, I mean, I had time there, but I had no memory of ever living in the United States up till then. It was really, for me, it was kind of, you heard people talk about it. You know what I mean? The U.S., yeah, back in the States. It's like, and I had no foundation of it. It was all just based on my imagination of what it would be like.
How was that for you then, like with education and schools and stuff? Did you find it easy to make friends, or did you miss friends?
I think a little bit of all of the above. I mean, for the most part, the schools we were in, because we were in military areas, they put us in, English speaking schools. But we had to learn the other languages and everything there. I mean, I spoke Thai fluently as a child, and I used to speak German fluently as well. Both I can't do at all, but it comes back. But so there were English speaking schools. The friends thing, when you're younger, you don't really miss friends when you move. You don't build those kind of relationships. It wasn't until I got closer to my teen years where the move started to feel like you were going to miss somebody.
Right.
You built that kind of relationships in yourself. But when you're really younger, it doesn't matter. It's, oh, we're going to a new place. Oh, cool. Yeah, we're going to Germany. Let's see what that's about. So you don't even really think about it.
So have you been back to the place in Scotland? Have you tracked it down or anything on tours or anything like that?
No, not since I was 5. We went back with my family and visited, but I'd love to check it out because, interestingly enough, it sounds like a made up story, but my first house was literally a castle. When we lived up there, it was Kinnard Castle up in Scotland. And basically what the Earl, his sister, I guess she'd be the Countess, I guess. Anyway, so they took one wing of the castle and they turned it into flats.
Right.
So my parents rented a flat there along with some other people that worked on base. So literally my first home was a castle. But I want to go back there one day. I've looked online. You can actually book out the castle. I don't think they do flats, but they do like kind of like vacation suites. It's a big hunting and game area. I guess the grounds are like 700 acres that they have up there. And so people go up there and they hunt and fish and enjoy nature and all that. So, yeah, that's kind of on one of my bucket list things is to go back up there and see that again.
Got to do it, man. So where did like music come into the whole picture? Because did you eventually move to Alaska?
Yeah. That was junior high school and the beginning of high school. You know, my dad was always just a huge, huge music fan and his record collection was amazing. So, I mean, my earliest memories are listening to the Beatles was one of my all-time favorites that I got into right away. And just things he had. I mean, he had everything basically just about every genre except for country. He wasn't a country fan, but he had classical, he had jazz, he had rock, he had pop stuff. I mean, he was all over the map. So, you know, I think that I learned my appreciation there.
Kind of grew up in the age of classic TV, movies, and great rock music of the late 70s and 80s. What was the kind of the first music which you identified as your own, breaking away from the stuff you're hearing from your dad? Was there any bands which kind of really grabbed you?
Well, yeah, of course. I mean, you know, some of the ones that I got from him were still staples and building blocks for me. I mean, I raided his record collection and stole, you know, like I said, some of his Beatles records. I snagged Pink Floyd out of his collection. I grabbed an Alice Cooper, Welcome to My Nightmare. I stole that out of his collection.
That seems to be one which gets mentioned all the time. It's always an Alice Cooper album.
Well, yeah, well, because he crossed over so many things. He had that hard rock world. And then he had, like, on that record, he had a huge pop hit with that Only Women Bleed song, which was very much orchestrated and strings. And so I think he crossed a lot of genres. But, you know, I did stuff. But I think on my own, probably when I got to like junior high school, I discovered Zeppelin and Van Halen. And I remember, I think I was in the sixth grade, maybe seventh grade, for my birthday. After seven. Anyway, I went out with my birthday money and I bought the first three Van Halen records because I just found them. And then also I got Pete Townsend's Empty Glass. I got The Clash, London Calling, and something else I don't remember. So, you know, it all came at once. You know, once you hit that age, and I remember being a kid and flipping through the radio dial at home alone, and I found the rock station. Like, my dad's was a little more contemporary rock. And I found the hard rock station, and that's where I found Van Halen. I'd never heard him before. And I was just like, what is this? And then it just took me down that rabbit hole of all these great rock bands. You know, I was already kind of primed for it, but it made a big impact on me. And I was off and running.
What was your first gig?
There's kind of like a multi-part to this. So as far as being inspired to play, I remember seeing, it was just this little cover band on a school trip when I was in the sixth grade, and I saw them and I just remember watching them and being mesmerized. All my friends were playing and running around and I just watched the band. Like, that was when I first kind of knew. I think later that year I had, my dad took me to a Styx concert.
Nice.
Which they were really huge then, which is my first experience at a real authentic concert, a real concert hall. And then the first one that I went to, purely motivated on my own, I lucked out when we were in Alaska and I saw Ozzy on the Diary of a Madman tour. And that was a great experience because that was at Eastside High School Auditorium. It held 2,000 people. I mean, it was literally a high school performance hall. And he did two shows that day. I caught the early show.
And how old was you then?
I was probably like 13, I'd say, you know, and you know, both kudos and what the hell were they thinking of my parents? Because we were living in the Aleutian Islands on a military base. And we just happened to be in Anchorage for, I don't know if we just went for a personal reason or whatever, but we were in town for like a weekend. And when we got there and we got in the car and I heard on the radio that he was playing, I was like, oh my God, I have to see this concert, right? Because I was a huge fan, loved Sabbath, loved Ozzy solo. And my parents at 13 years old gave me money for the concert ticket and dropped me off at the high school and picked me up a few hours later.
Did you come out a totally different kid?
If nothing else, I was deaf for 3 days. My ears literally rang for 3 days before my hearing returned to normal.
Who was playing guitar for Ozzy on that tour?
That was Brad Gillis at that point. That was, this was literally like a month after Randy Rhoads had passed away. And I didn't even know who was playing guitar. Like, you know, all at last I'd heard that Randy had passed away. I didn't even know they were touring.
I guess Ozzy was still like, back then, the scary guy. It was still like a big deal. back then, almost like the Marilyn Manson of the 90s, and Halsey was still terrifying.
Yeah, exactly. Everybody's believing the press and all the crazy stuff, you know, and I'm sure, you know, in his own way, he was terrifying because he was still, you know, drinking and partying heavy back then.
Awesome. So when did you'd seen the band playing live at a local show. Was that the kind of pathway to you wanting to pick up guitar or bass from there? Or
yeah, I think so. I think all my life I'd always, you know, had a huge affinity for music. I just remember being a kid, even like, you know, when we'd go to like see parades, I loved when the bands came by, and I just loved that visceral feeling of when the drum section came by, you know, and all the guys with the marching drums and everything. And so, I mean, I was always drawn to it, and I always had this, you know, little kid fantasy of, you know, one day I'm going to be a musician, I'm going to do this. And I took guitar lessons in the fifth grade, and it was horrendous, and it made me feel that I was never going to be able to do this, and it was awful. I mean, we were in there for 6 weeks. We learned the first five frets of the high three string single notes, and we were playing, you know, Auld Lang Syne and things like that. And I was like, this is not what I signed up for. I want to play rock guitar. I want to learn to play these songs that I'm hearing on the radio and on my records. And I felt like it was so far off from what I wanted that it was unobtainable for me.
Especially if you've been listening to like Van Halen and Ozzy, and then you're just doing these little single note things. It's like, is this the same instrument?
Yeah. Where's the distortion? Where's the big amp sound? You know, and as a kid, you don't know how to make that. I mean, you know, I didn't have any of that around me, so I wasn't able to see it happen in front of me.
So guitar transition to bass, what was the kind of link into that? Was that just by necessity or?
Well, it was a more opportunity. When we moved to Alaska, I wanted to get a nice, easy gimme class, you know, as all kids do in the eighth grade, right? And so I wanted to sign up for a music class, and I was hoping that I could learn guitar there. It was another attempt of maybe somebody can teach me this instrument. As luck would have it, the music teacher for the school, this was a very small school. I mean, our high school and junior high had 217 students combined that year. So, but he came in and he said, you know, our school band stuff is not that big. He goes, I really don't have room for it. And furthermore, I really can't teach you guitar. He goes, but I could use a bass for like, you know, jazz band and pep band and whatever else stuff. You know, they would come out and we'd play during the half times of the basketball. So I could use that. And I was like, sold. I can spend a one period every day in a class learning how to play an instrument. You got me. So that was where I got in. And I kind of went back and forth jamming with my friends. I played both guitar and bass. But when I got a little older, I made a realization that everyone I knew played guitar. And if I played guitar, I could probably wrangle some friends and make a band of leftovers. But if I played bass, I could probably get in a band with all the guys who I wanted to play like. So I could get into a way better band. And that was always a motivation to me. I always wanted to be in with guys that were better than me.
Right.
Because it was going to raise my level up, you know, rather than languish in even at our age of mediocrity, because you kind of stay there, right? So you want to be challenged. So I took that as a good opportunity.
How was it going into bass? Was it like an instrument you'd paid much attention to beforehand, or was it a whole new world?
A little bit of both. I mean, I think that, you know, I listened to music my whole life and I paid attention to so much of it. And obviously being, you know, a big Beatles fan and, you know, and the Zeppelin stuff, you know, the bass was all there.
It kind of made sense all of a sudden. Oh, that's what I was hearing.
Yeah, it basically made me focus on it. You know, I remember my mom saying that, like, you know, once I had signed up for the class that, you know, I'd be at the house and I'd say, hey, mom, listen to this thing. Hear that right there? That's the bass. That's what I'm going to play. Like, so, you know, I mean, I knew it was there. It changed my focus.
Was it just like Paul McCartney players, or was there anybody else from the rock scene which you were drawn to?
Oh, no, there were tons of them. I mean, obviously, you know, John Paul Jones. I mean, Geezer Butler was a huge influence for me. Matter of fact, I think the first record that I attempted to learn every song on all the way through was Sabbath's Paranoid.
Right.
You know, and then of course you listen to guys like Geddy Lee and you just go, well, at least I can listen to him, right? You know, later on I learned to play his stuff. But in the beginning, you're like, okay, I'm going to stick to something a little easier, you know. I think the first song I learned to play was a record I stole from my dad's collection. And I learned a Bachman Turner Overdrive song called Not Fragile. And it was so great because it was pretty much four notes over and over. Da 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 da. You know what I mean? So it's like, as a kid, that's great. Repetitive. That's what I needed to learn.
Was you always learning by ear then? Did you just enjoy listening to records and picking out the parts?
Yeah, the majority of it. I mean, I think that, you know, I always tell kids nowadays, you know, when I've taught lesson things, like, you guys are so lucky. You can go to the internet, you know, in 30 seconds, you can find a video of somebody showing you, if not exactly, pretty much how to play something. And we didn't have that luxury.
The amount of songs I've learned from like 15-year-old kids when I'm trying to figure out a song and just pull it up on YouTube. Oh, that's how they do it.
Of course. I mean, you know, with the when I was doing the Candlebox stuff, Kevin and I will do acoustic shows every once in a while. And, you know, most of the solos I just, because I'll play guitar on those. And most of the solos I just fake my way through, but there's a couple like far behind in particular that I'm like, I need to do my best to play that solo. And so I'm not great at learning solos by ear, you know, because that was never my wheelhouse. So I literally found a guy on YouTube. I searched through the videos. I'm like, this guy's playing it right. Cause I stood next to these guys for all these years. I'm like, okay, I know this guy's pretty much got this. So I'm going to watch his video and learn how to play this. Takes the guesswork out.
So what were you kind of early bands? What kind of direction was it going in? Was you just joining bands that needed bass players, or did you seek out something in a particular style?
I think, you know, both. I mean, I think you kind of always know what excites you and, you know, the sound you like and the things you want to go for. I think there was a mix of, so when I started really playing out, this was in Hawaii at this point. I was living there. I went to high school in Hawaii. And so there was a lot of opportunities for cover bands. You know, you could do a lot of that because there were so many, you know, tourist places and military bases you could play at. They were kind of crossing, but at one point the year after I graduated high school, I was in six bands. Some of them shed it off, but you know what I mean? It was like in a transition point, I was in six different bands because I was just looking to play, you know? And if you're playing in a cover band, yeah, you hope there's songs that you like, but you're not so worried about the overall sound of the band because it's not really your band. You're just playing music, which is fun. And then when you're making your own original band, now you're looking for a particular sound. You're a lot more critical and particular about what you want it to be because now it's yours and you're creating it.
Am I right? You joined Legs Diamond pretty young, right?
Yeah. That was like my first like actual pro gig. First time I was on a tour bus. We toured the UK in 92.
Wow.
Yeah. My first tour was with those guys.
How did that whole thing come about? Was you kind of finding yourself progressing to bigger bands?
Well, you know, I think it was kind of, it was just, again, the big thing is opportunity. You know what I mean? And when I first came to LA, I used the Musicians Institute as my reason to move to LA. Because I came here, as far as I knew, I didn't know anybody here. I was spent a misguided year in Florida, didn't work out the way I wanted, and decided I'm going to come to LA because this is apparently where it's all at, right?
And is this pre-Legs Diamond?
Yeah. So this is leading up to this. So in music school, there was a guy that I knew. He was apprenticing at a music store as a luthier. So he was finishing up school and moving back home, strangely enough, to Alaska, but I didn't know him there. Totally different part of the state. It's a very big state. And he's like, hey, I feel so bad. I'm leaving and I'm going to leave my guy that I'm without help. And I'm like, wait a minute. You mean there's an open spot to learn to fix guitars in a guitar shop? And he's like, yeah. He goes, why? Are you interested? I'm like, yes, 100%. So I got in there and I did that. And I did that for a few years. But the keyboard player for Legs Diamond also worked at the music store selling keyboards and doing other in pro audio and all that stuff. And so he knew me. And when they were throwing something together, he was like, hey, you want to come down and audition for us? And I got the gig.
Wow.
Just a circumstance. So we played, it was really weird because I had never been in any sort of a band that was known beyond my high school friends. So to have random people grabbing at you, it kind of freaked me out at first. It was really weird. It was still in the days of kind of that star adulation. And I remember we did a signing, a New Year's party. And I remember these girls would come by and they come through and they, can we get a kiss? I was like, yeah, sure. And I leaned over the table and they grabbed me and almost pulled me over the table. Like it was a little much for me, like all at once. And I remember at one point during the signing, I'm like, I'm going to be back. I'm going to go grab a beer. And I went back in the dressing room. It was just like, what is happening out there? You know, I mean, it was all cool. I just wasn't mentally prepared for it.
Was the rest of the guys quite a bit older than you or?
Yeah. So I was probably anywhere from 10 to 15 years younger than all those guys. You know, I mean, they got their first record deal when I was in the fifth grade. You know what I mean? So, but it, you know, it was good because, I mean, it really raised my level up. It was the first time I got to play with a really, really good spot on drummer. At that time, Dusty Watson was playing drums for them and he's played with everybody. I mean, Dick Dale, Agent Orange, Super Suckers. He's out now with the Sonics, which was a huge band, been around for decades. You know, so he's one of those guys. He plays, but he really helped snap me too. You know what I mean? As far as this looseness you have. No, listen to this. You're missing this. You're missing that. And he said it so very just like matter of factly. It was a little disarming at first, but then I learned like, wow, he's absolutely right. Now that I'm paying attention to this subtlety, he's got it. you know, awesome. and it helped me come a long way. So it was really good for me.
Was that your first international touring experience then, you say?
Yeah. Yeah. And we, one of the first shows, well, it was probably actually the third show with them in the States. We played, we used to play this huge festival in San Antonio, Texas every year where the band was literally on the level of Guns N' Roses at that point in that town. They had one song that was for decades the most requested song in San Antonio rock radio history. So we were huge. And the first show I did in that city with them, I walked out on a stage, massive stage in front of 30,000 people. Like, I had no idea what to do. I'd never been on a festival stage in my life. You know, the second time we did it, I was able to run around a bit and do more. I was in a little, I mean, I moved around, but I was just like, I didn't know what to do with the space, you know? So it was, again, another thing that really helped me raise my game to that next level.
Awesome. Is it still an active band? Because I know I mentioned you was doing like the, was you continuing to play at San Antonio, just like a one-off festival?
Yeah, yeah. Every once in a while. I mean, you know, the guys, we still want to do, we were supposed to do a show actually this month or last month in Texas. We were supposed to have a new record out. The COVID stuff came along and we were actually supposed to play in May in San Antonio. So it really comes down to just like kind of one-off gigs, and the guys want to do at least one last album. So it's still being talked about. It's in the works. It's not a huge time commitment gig, so it's not anything I have to worry about against anything else. We just, hey, do we have a hole in the schedule? Okay, we can book that weekend and we'll do it. And we do like literally like two gigs every 3 years, it seems like.
So when was your time at like GIT then? Was that around like very early 90s?
Yeah, late 80s. Yeah.
Did your playing like go through the roof from them? Did it expose you to all different things, or just maybe just highlight things a little bit?
Yeah, I mean, it brought out some things. That in itself didn't make a drastic change in my playing. It made a change in my mentality and my focus. I realized that there were so many different styles. I wasn't going to be able to follow them all. And that school was open to all that kind of stuff. There are a few poignant moments in that school. I remember there was a kid, a bass player from, I think it was from Sweden. And he was a great jazz player, could play all the charts, all the stuff. And one day he said, hey, I want you to teach me how to play rock. And I looked at him like, are you an idiot? You play eighth notes. Like what? He's like, I just don't get it. And I didn't get that he didn't get that. And I realized that I was struggling to learn what he knew, and that, you know, it's good to know some things, but if you know the style you want to play, be good at that. You know, I did a Latin jazz class. You learn a song and you get up there and you jam it with the band, you play through. And then the instructors for each particular instrument come through and they critique you on what you did, yada, yada. So I did the song and the guy was teaching the class. I felt it was both very good and very bad. He said, that was really good. He goes, you copped that feel. You got it. He goes, if you go out and you play this style of music for about 5 years, you'll be one of the top guys. And I realized, I don't want to play this style of music for 5 years. So I immediately was like, why waste my time with this? Because this isn't my pursuit. Playing wise, what really got me is I took lessons for about a year or two in the early 2000s from a jazz bass player, Bunny Brunell, who's played with Chick Corea, Herbie Hancock. I mean, he's one of those guys. He's one of the big four as far as bass players go. And he really, really upped my game. He got me to the point where I had no fear of any spot on the neck anymore. Wow. I knew everything, you know. He had a great system, and it was very much like the Karate Kid thing. You know, it's like, okay, play this scale this way. No, not in that position. Play it this way. Play this way. Okay, now play this one this way. Okay, now play this mode this way. And he worked me up to, we started, you know, just C major. And then it was like, okay, now let's look at the theory. This chord, it has these notes that are key in it. What scale overlays on this? Great. Okay, now here's a chord chart. Play the scale for this chord. Play the scale for this chord. He goes, now you just play through a chart you've never seen because you know what these modes are. You can do it. He goes, now forget about playing the scale and just play, switch to these modes. And he was able to do that to me, which was huge for me.
How did that like collaboration come together?
Oh man, you know, I don't know exactly how I found him. I do know that he taught at Carvin, had a store in both in Hollywood and the Valley out here. And he taught lessons there. And that's where I took the lessons. But I can't remember exactly what brought me to him.
Right.
But it was great. Like I said, I can't say enough about what he did.
How did you and Kevin Martin come to know each other?
Through a mutual friend. So my wife works for Universal Music out here. And there was this guy, Dave Schwartz, who was a sales rep there and worked with my wife. And he is a really good friend of Kevin's. And he's a huge fan of the band, huge Pearl Jam guy, probably one of the biggest Pearl Jam fans in the world. Because Kevin had a record deal for the High Watts and the company folded, Gold Circle Records. And so suddenly he had essentially no band, and he had, was working on getting his album back from the company, getting the rights to it. So then he was wanting to put together a band, and our mutual friend Dave said, hey, I think I know the guy for you. This guy, Adam, I think would be perfect for this. And so we met and we talked, and I didn't hear anything from him for about 5 months. And he called me up one day and says, hey, we're going on tour in 2 weeks. Can you do it? And that was that. You know, that tour actually fell through, but 2 months later, we were on the road.
That seems to be, I've seen come across that. You like put the feelers out for something and I guess I didn't get that then last minute.
It's you never know how it's all going to play out. There's gigs you think you've got for sure and they go with someone else and vice versa, but it worked out.
So was it a logical thing for you to join Candlebox in, was it 2007 when they kind of reformed?
They all got back together, and Kevin had brought Sean Hennessy, who was in the High Watts, over to Candlebox as the second guitar player. Yeah, Barty, the original bass player, he, in his time when the band was down, when he was out of Candlebox, he finished up a law degree. So he was working on that. And at that time, when they got back together in 2006, he was getting ready to take the bar. And then he passed the bar. And then just, he had other things going on, and the guys just felt that he maybe wasn't fully invested in it as they would like him to be. So they asked him to go out. And thankfully, Sean chirped in Kevin's ear and says, yeah, I'm sure Adam would be here in days and would have this whole thing down. And so Kevin reached out and it worked out.
Was that the first time they'd reformed since like the heyday?
Yeah, they broke up in 99. In 2006, they got back together.
What was the response when they first went out?
Oh, it's huge. I mean, the band in the 90s was, selling out, arenas, hockey arenas, and they were, gigantic. So when they came back out in 2006, the touring landscape had changed a bit, such that they were doing a lot of festivals and things like that. So yeah, there was still, huge draw for the band and everything. And, and it's a really good live band. Kevin's a great singer, great front man. So they're always going to have fans. The band's always going to be able to do touring and have fans out there. Very grateful.
How does someone like Kevin approach the band nowadays, with it being a band, like you say, with that legacy and that history? There's obviously a lot of nostalgia that goes with it as well for a lot of people, I guess. But how does he kind of balance that with writing new material and keeping the fans happy? Does it just kind of go hand in hand, and he's kind of content with where the band is?
I think that, as artists and performers, you're always hoping to release something that eclipses everything you've done. No one's going to lie to you and tell you they wouldn't like to do that. But you're also realistic in that catching lightning in a bottle, not just in your creative effort and the record you release, but also the right timing in the world for it, the fan base, the business powers. The High Watts record was great. It should have done things, but we didn't have a label and we couldn't pay the radio stations to play us. The two cities that played the record, we had sold out shows.
Right.
We go to other cities and we'd have nobody. So you learn that very quickly. So if the industry is not supporting you, if you don't have the right radio support, it's tough. I think he's also very grateful, for the fan base, from the fans from the 90s, because that allows you to go out there and tour and release those new records. That being said, the fan base that comes out really seems to like the new records. They all have different favorites and things, but I feel like by and large that they do accept the new records and they enjoy them. So you mix up your set. It's a very welcome, high grade problem to have, to sit down and look at a set list and go, oh shit, but now we're not playing this one, or not, oh God, I wish we could get this one in the set. It's nice to have that luxury.
How familiar was you with the band? Were you a fan from back in the day, or was you moving in different kind of musical circles?
I was a bit of a fan, but honestly, I wasn't digging too much into everything, because right around the time that record came out, I was living back in Hawaii. My wife had gotten sent there for work and we were having our first child, and I had some other things on my mind. And then we were trying to move back to Los Angeles. Like for me, that everything was kind of in the background for me musically, because I had so many other priorities up front. But the things I had heard of the band, I did love. I definitely dug the sound of the band and liked the music. I just never got deep into the catalog. Actually, strangely enough, when we were in Hawaii, a woman that worked at this gym my wife went to, she got to be good friends with her. And one day she said, brought my wife a cassette and said, hey, my parents' neighbors in Seattle have a band. And she handed her the first Candlebox CD. So apparently this woman's parents lived next door to Pete Klett's family.
Wow.
Of all things, like, so weird. So like my wife was more aware of the band than I was, you know, I was panicking and flying back and forth and just a mess.
How was it for you, like, to kind of put things in parallel with like the Legs Diamond thing where you said the reaction from the fans and stuff? How was it going out with Candlebox and seeing fans' reaction to like Kevin and stuff like that? Was it any kind of similar parallels where people kind of, it's the band which changed their life when they were growing up, and meet that guy and stuff like that? Do you see kind of similar things?
Sure. Yeah. No, he's got an amazing draw and rapport with the fans. You know, again, having seen it once and experienced it once, I wasn't shocked by it. You know what I mean? So I kind of expected it to be that way. And it was, you know, I think that, you know, going with Kevin, like even back to the High Watts days, is my first time seeing people who are kind of stalkers. We did have a few that Kevin had to like, okay, you're not allowed anymore. Like it got too deep back in those days. Like I said, that aspect I was prepared for, but it is amazing to see the connection he has with fans.
So to bring things to present day, can you tell us a little of how Sons of Silver came about? Because it kind of formed from the PRG band, which I saw you guys play in Nottingham. And the band's also got Dave Cruzan in there, known for his work with Pearl Jam, who also plays in Candlebox.
Yes.
So as usual, the music business is very incestual when it comes to musicians in various bands. So at what point did Sons of Silver come to be?
Well, it was just really in the writing process because, see, I was in a band with Pete years ago called Last December. So we've known each other that long. And that band kind of, we had some good stuff, but things changed in time and it kind of fell apart. So then Pete started writing songs on his own, just because he didn't really have a band. He decided to go more acoustic. And he started with that. And then he felt that he wanted to have some players on it. So he asked me to come play and I brought Dave in. And so we did that. And Dave eventually brought Kevin in. We started like that, where we were kind of the session band for Pete RG. But then we were also the touring band if we went out and did shows. And then we got to a point where just naturally in the studio, we started coming up with ideas, just fooling around, that became songs. And then Pete realized like, hey, this is actually way easier and way better to let these songs just happen naturally rather than it all come from him. And to be fair, I think that when you're writing by yourself and the acoustic guitar, you tend to write those kind of songs. And I think he also realized that he had a lot of those songs and this was something fresh and new, but with his voice on it and all still the same players, it was cohesive. So then once he realized that we were writing as a band, that was when he wanted to make the change from Pete RG to Sons of Silver, because it was now an official band rather than, you know, a singer-songwriter with a backing band.
Awesome. So how long has it been Sons of Silver?
I want to say about a year, maybe.
Yeah.
I don't know exactly when it changed, because obviously we were Pete RG when we did that UK tour. Really, this EP that just came out is the first thing I think labeled officially Sons of Silver. And we were working on these songs last year.
Right.
Even that, I feel that we have a couple more EPs worth in the works. We probably have another 15 or 20 songs that are in various stages of completion. And I feel that those are even better than this last EP. So I'm excited, looking forward. We're really starting to hit a stride with things. We're trying to push, and I know it's one of my big things, is we're trying to make sure that each song has its own unique sound and space. You know, one of my favorite bands of all time was Queen, because they didn't stick to any one particular thing. They let the players and singers in the band dictate the cohesiveness of the sound, but stylistically, they were all over the map. And I think if you can establish that width of your style and what you can do early on, fans will accept it, you know, going forward. I mean, not everybody can be AC/DC. I love AC/DC. The fact that they can do essentially the same record year after year and you love it. Like I've heard that new song. It's amazing. It sounds like AC/DC and it makes you happy.
Exactly. So in the current climate, things are on hold for bands, particularly with touring. But right. What is next on the horizon? Will it be a full length album, or do you think you're just kind of, is an EP the way to go forward? Because Read 'Em the Rights is such a great tune, by the way.
Oh, thank you.
Stomper, man.
You're right.
Do you think our EPs are a more digestible way to kind of bring a new band in?
Yeah, I think so. And I've long been a proponent of the whole thing of more small releases rather than one big release, because, you know, if you're waiting to knock out 12 songs all at once, then it takes you twice as long to get to your next release. And, you know, fans are fickle. There's so much out there. There's so much coming at you. And unless you're a mega star, you can't afford to disappear for a year. So you always need to be having that contact, I think, with your fans. And, hey, remember us? Here's something new. Check it out, you know. And hopefully they're going on that journey with you. So, yeah, the plan is that even though we have all these songs, is just to release them an EP at a time and have more releases.
The artwork's really cool as well. Who's kind of behind all that?
Thanks. Well, you know, Pete and Brina kind of head up the whole direction of things. I know that they have, I'm not sure the name of the guy, but they have people that do some of the stuff, but they're very much in contact and give, you know, general direction and stuff like that. You know, I think Breen is very artistic in that regard and really helps with that.
Kind of finally, who do you think would be a great touring match for you guys? I could see you on bills with pretty much anybody. I was trying to think of some bands, like obviously like Foo Fighters would be great, Queens of the Stone Age, but then through to someone like even like ZZ Top. Like a big festival or something, it just sure. kind of sit just right. Who would you particularly like if you could choose anybody?
Well, I mean, just for personal reasons, yeah, obviously the Foo Fighters would be amazing, but I, you know, I don't know that we get that gig. It's kind of weird question for me, and I think for us as a band, because when these rock comparisons were coming out, these harder rock bands, it really kind of shocked us. Like,
right.
It didn't feel we were that band because we came from an acoustic-driven singer-songwriter band, and then we were very indie, but now people are putting us on active rock charts, and like, I'm very grateful, I love it, but I don't know that I fully understand it, because I think because we're in the creative side of it, and we're not hearing it as a, you know, unbiased listener, so to speak. So I don't know. I mean, honestly, it's really just anyone that can get you out in front of people, I'm open to. We've done a lot of support for Candlebox just because it's worked out very convenient. I think what we're doing musically now fits way better than when we did do the Candlebox supporting things, because the style was more singer-songwriter back then. Yeah, you know, I don't know. I mean, I could even see us going out with people like, you know, like John Mayer or somebody. You know what I mean? Like, I could see us going out, you know, with some of these indie bands. I mean, we're not as eclectic and stuff, but I mean, to go out with like a Radiohead would be incredible. I mean, we're not going to get that gig either, but you know.
It's kind of a nice problem to have, like, well, we'll just go out with anybody. We'll sit comfortably on any bill.
Well, I think so. I think that, you know, none of these bands that we're mentioning, do I go, oh, that's a bad fit, you know what I mean, musically. So it really just boils down to the opportunities, and we'll take them when they come. You know, I mean, it's probably going to be next summer at best, you know.
See what happens. Definitely, man. Well, thank you ever so much for your time, Adam. I really appreciate it. It's been cool to chat, and been lovely to talk a little bit of bass. I don't normally get to do that in interviews, which has been good.
Yeah. We'll talk a little bass. What's your go-to instrument?
I'm a Fender jazz guy. I've been for quite some time. I started on precision, but then I got the jazz, and I've also got this thing here. I'm gonna say,
oh, nice, yes.
When people say who's your favorite Beatle, I always say Stuart Sutcliffe.
Yeah, right. Yeah, here I'll show you my one for that. This is my.
Oh, nice, man.
It's a 72.
Can't go wrong with that. Those things always sound insanely awesome.
I use that bass. I've got flat wounds on it, so I'm going for that very warm, you know, McCartney-esque kind of thing. Actually, I used it on a few songs on Giles' record.
Yeah. Oh, nice. How was it recording with Dave? Did you have good fun?
Oh, it was great. It was a blast. I can't wait to do it again. We're hopefully going to do some more stuff. But yeah, it was a good time. I mean, that whole experience in Nashville was just amazing. And Dave, I mean, you know, Dave, he's a fun, jovial guy. He's very energetic. You know, we had all kinds of great conversation, not only recording together, but we also all lived in an Airbnb for that whole week together. So, you know, we'd record all day, then we go back to the house and make dinner, all of us together. And it was a good time.
His projects, which he's doing, is just so cool. He's just so focused on like, right, this is the next big thing, what I'm going to do. And have you seen he's doing like the Abbey Road project at the moment?
Yeah, I'm hoping to be involved in that. That would be absolutely incredible. A dream come true. But he's right. And he's smart because he is getting, you know, fan support for his recordings. His vision of that is right. Is you can't just go, hey, I'm raising money to go in the studio. It has to be an event. You know, I'm going to Nashville to make an Americana record. I'm going to Abbey Road. It's something special. And then you can film it and document it. And it becomes, you know, a much bigger thing than just, I want to record some songs.
Literally becomes like a time capsule, which everybody's involved in. And yeah, it's really awesome. So yeah, for him to achieve the Nashville thing and then to bring the band to the UK was just amazing. Very, very cool. So yeah, I'm excited for him.
He's just a good guy. I can't say enough good about him, which is why the whole thing that UK tour came together is because we were saying, hey, wouldn't it be fun to play these songs as a band in the UK? And I was like, yeah. And he's like, well, I really can't afford it. And that's when I threw out the idea of, I go, look, we've got our band, Pete RG. We'd love to come play Europe too. If you share some of the band members, and then maybe one artist pays for the flights, another artist pays for hotels, now you brought the cost way down and it worked out and it became manageable. So like you say, it's very incestuous with us musicians, but when you work with people that you like, you know, you find ways to make things happen. And it's always a good time. You know, we're always willing to do those things because at the end of the day, you'd rather do that fun tour or do that great session than sit home.
And chances are most other tours where you think you're going to get some money, it's all going to lose out anyway.
You don't expect to, especially when you're trying to break bands, you don't expect to make money on tour. You just hope to not lose money. I did a tour in, I think, 99 in Japan. And we were over there for 2 weeks, played a whole bunch of cities. And we just got expenses. Hotels were covered, meals were covered, and that was pretty much it, right? But it was an experience, so I did it. And I called home twice, and I dipped my credit card into the machine. I've spent $350 on 15 minutes worth of phone time.
Holy shit.
yeah, that was it. So I learned really fast, like, okay, we don't do that again. But, you know, it's for the love of music, you know? So the days that you are playing a gig where you're actually getting money in your pocket, you're happy. But, you know, it is, we're musicians. We're going to play regardless. And you just want to be involved with good music and people that you enjoy.
Well, I hope you get to come back to the UK soon. And I'll have to buy you a beer in Nottingham or something like that.
Definitely. And then I'll buy you one someplace else. It's a deal.
Great, it was Adam. I want to thank him for taking the time to chat to me on the Straight to Video podcast, and be sure to head on over to sonsofsilver.com to keep up to date with the band and to listen to the new Doomsday Noises EP. That's all for this episode. Thanks as always for tuning in. Keep up with the shares and follows, and thank you to everyone who has left a review recently, as it all goes towards spreading the good word. So until next time, look after yourselves, and we'll chat again soon.